all the European countries. So in all the 27 European countries. Now the problem was that this member country, this organization has to reach out to all the 27 data protection authorities saying that this is the data that I'm going to process. Now, since there was a flexibility for the member countries, the notification process was different. One was required to directly reach out to the data protection authority, someone was required to register in a website, someone was required to drop a post or an email to the data protection authority. So as an MNC, you are forced to study all the practices of all the member countries, then come up and notify all the data protection authorities. If you miss even one data protection authority, then you will be fined. So that was, there was huge problem for all the companies with the data protection directive, because even though the guidelines are consistent, the implementation part had a flexibility, and that led to inconsistencies across the European Union. So 2000 Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. So what happened in the 2000 was, like, similar to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, from which the European Convention of Human Rights has come into picture, European Union has adopted the European Convention of Human Rights. So that became Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. So they adopted all those things, and so all the European Union data subjects had started having that as a fundamental right based on their constitution. And in 2000, they have also introduced something called as e-commerce directive. So e-commerce directive was law specifically addressed to the e-commerce websites. So if someone is selling goods online, so e-commerce directive will be applicable for them. In the year 2002, they have introduced EU directive on privacy and electronic communication. So if you see the existing cookie policy or website communication, that has been origin from this EU directive on privacy and electronic communications. So that was the intent. So whatever the communication happens over the electronic channels, so they wanted to have a directive around that. So if you see 1980s, at that time maybe electronic communication was not as popular as in the terms of 1990s or the 2000s. So they felt that there is a gap in how the data is being processed in electronic communication. So they have come up with a new law for the privacy and electronic communications. Human rights that we have discussed previously, European Convention of Human Rights or the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So Lisbon Treaty basically talks about everyone has the right to respect for his or her private life at home, and communication. So Article 7 talks about the respect to private life, and Article 8 talks about the data protection practices that should be implemented. So that's what Lisbon Treaty talks about. Since it has been adopted by all the member countries, it has given a legislative effect where the fundamental rights are mandated from the legislation itself. So even the data protection authority that we see has origin from the Lisbon Treaty itself. So if you see the European Parliament, I will start with the Parliament because that is easy to understand. It's very similar to the Indian Parliament. European Parliament shall jointly with the Council. When we say Council, it's the European Council, access legislative and budgetary function. So it's a legislative body, and it shall access functions of political control and consultation as lowered down in the treaties. It shall elect the president of the commission. So it elects the president of the European Commission. So basically, European Parliament, similar to our member of parliament, for member of European Parliaments are elected directly by the citizen through direct voting. So they'll be voting, and the members of the MEP will be elected member of European Parliament. Once they are elected, similar to the voting rights that we have in our Indian Parliament, whenever there is a new bill that comes, there will be a committee that is established, and that particular committee will go through that particular bill and identify and see if there are any changes to be made. There will be a discussion on that bill, and once all the members of that particular parliament approves that, then that the bill will become a law. So that's how the European generally works. So the first responsibility of the European Parliament is the legislative process, to develop the legislative process. Since this is a democratic body where the members are elected through democratic process, it will help us the democratic legitimacy of the European law. So whatever, basically the citizens, kind of citizens have approved that particular law. That's how the democracy is prevailing there. So whenever there is a bill, there are three kinds of procedures. One is ordinary procedure. The second one is a consultation procedure. Third one is a consent procedure. That's how the bills work. So when we say ordinary procedure, module one, so we can do similar to the questions that appear in the CIPP exam in general. So just for you to have a flavor, you can go through this.
Just confused between B and D.
What do you think will be the right answer? Anyone else with any other options? So the correct option is B for Bombay here. The right to privacy has to be balanced against other rights under ECHR. So if you see the option A, the right to privacy is an absolute right. Is no right is absolute right. So whenever there's other rights also, if every right is absolute right, then no right will make sense. So the first option is not the one right answer. The C point C, if right to freedom of expression under Article 10 of ECHR will always override the right to privacy. No. Even right to freedom is also not an absolute right. So if it cannot override the right to privacy. If you see the option D, the right to privacy protects the right to hold opinions. Right to privacy doesn't protect the right to hold opinions. If you are holding opinions in a discriminatory way, or if you're influencing the opinions of others, then right to privacy is, you are violating the right to privacy of other individual. So the correct option is here is right to privacy has to be balanced against other rights under ECHR, European Convention on Human Rights. Basis, if you want to process, it has to be undone under a supervision of a specialist person. So for example, we do the background verifications, right? So the background verifications does involve police verification report. So whenever we do a police verification report, there are chances that we might come across his prior convictions, right? So those kind of information should be kept confidential, should not be stored where it's publicly accessible, or like should not be accessible to every person. The only report that should be in general for BGV should be is a green yes or no, as simple as that. All the rest of the information is not important for the company. In similar way, the criminal records, it also whether the particular person is still facing the criminal charges or the charges has been closed and he has paid the respective penalties or not. That's the information we need to consider. So different countries have the different laws that are stated. So for example, US, they have sealed, they completely don't process prior convention. So for example, someone belongs to a less than 18 or a minor, all his criminal records will be kept under seal and it's not accessible even to the background verification vendors. That information will not be revealed. So those kind of practices are there. So based on the member state or the member country where your operations are there, so before processing criminal convictions, we need to refer to the local laws regarding the background verification and processing of criminal convictions. So this kind of processing should be carried out only under the control of official authority, and the processing should be authorized by the union or the member state law. That's what the GDPR says about. Any questions around processing of criminal data? I'll take it as a no. So just go back to the data that you are processing in your organization. So what do you think the sensitive personal data that you have processed in your organization? Can you think about any sensitive personal data that you have processed in terms of Indian context? You can think.
That's employee information.
So insurance related information of employee, health insurance related information.
All right, health insurance related. So for example, whenever providing health insurance at that time, if the employee declares that he is suffering with a particular illness, those kind of information will be coming.
Correct.
Sensitive personal information. Any other information that you are coming?